a couple of talks this morning, three talks this morning. I have been able to list four and after good.
Okay, thank you. Hello, everybody. Welcome to DevConf. I was not really aware that it would be my talk. That's the first to introduce in DevConf, and maybe that's the reason because not so many people are here. Because I doubt that it's the weather condition which makes this room so less crowded. Because the weather in Scotland is either cloudy, rainy, or foggy, so it's quite normal today, or not? At least it's my precondition. I wasn't here before, so sorry. Now to the talk. Well, there is no free beer served in this talk. I'm very sorry. Not in the early morning, but perhaps in the afternoon. The intention of this talk was to explain my mother and my colleagues what I'm just doing. I learned that it's quite hard to explain what are you doing with this stupid computer. It's everybody says something about free software, but what is it? What are you doing? And I had serious trouble, and so I slept some nights and thought, well, perhaps I should prepare a talk. And in this talk, I want to give some, or want to explain some thought, what is software at all? What might people understand a software with a little different point of view compared to hardware? And then I will go very few over the patent issue and come to the main point that free software means not only free of charge, but something more. Moreover, I want to talk a little bit about knowledge. Knowledge also compared to free software, free knowledge. And I will tell you about some alternatives to commercial knowledge if you think about some dictionaries you have to buy or whatever. And at last, I want to tell you something about the power of a distribution. Well, we are on the Debian conference. We are building a distribution and why I think it is very powerful. So now to the part of the hard and software comparison. If you think about anywhere, a vendor and a vendee have the chance to write the ware. And in most cases, or quite often, the price is dependent from the byte. If you buy 1 kilogram of sugar, 2 kilograms are double the price, or whatever. You can bite on it, you can have a disc and bite on it, that's fine. You can throb it, you can do whatever you can do with a physical thing. So, and both people, vendor and vendee, are able to check the ware. You can go to the marketplace and check whether it is fresh or good and fits your expectations. And the vendee has some certain rights. He has the ownership. If you buy the chair, you can put your chair in your home, sit on it, it's fine. You can change it. You can think, well, this chair is nice, but well, I would like a red color and you paint it red. Fine, it's your perfect right. And finally, if you think, well, right was not the right color, I tried to sell this chair, you can do it and nobody would care about it. If you think, I would like to duplicate this chair, it's not the best idea if you are not very good in handicraft, and it is better if some professionals do duplicates of this hardware. So you will normally not think about it. What about software? It is really aware in the sense I told in the previous slide. Does it have a weight? Well, not really. So the comparison with the double weight is a double price, it doesn't work. It is checkable. Well, if you go to the shop and want to buy a box, you have mostly no chance to check whether it fits your expectations and so on. So what is your right if you
buy a license to use the software. Well, you have the right to use, okay? But you have not the right to change something. And the right to use, well, perhaps you know it. People learned that if there is a installer and you click on the installer and there comes a license screen, there's below on the bottom is the checkbox. You have to check it and say next, and this works. Nobody will care what is this strange text, which is hard to read, and, well, it just works if you click the button and next. So, and you mostly are not noticing that you have not really also the right to sell the software to somebody else or whatever. So the rights are really restricted compared to the hardware you might have bought. But duplication would be normally easy, and so it is prevented by technical means, whatever these means are. You know, different examples. And so the difference between hardware and software is in the rights of the usage, and also that you are not really able to verify if the software is fulfilling the purpose the vendor is promising. So if you go to the marketplace, you have some odor of some bad-smelling fish, and you know this guy, people come to him, and he will be forced to sell fresh fish. And you have no idea whether software stinks or not. And, well, sometimes it is quite hard to find out that the software is not doing what it is supposed to do, that it has bugs, and you have to care about the software. You ask the company whether they could fix a bug, and so it is very different if you compare this hardware and software stuff. So this is one side I want to explain for the software in general. Now I come to something which is an interesting effect, because you have patents. Patents are a nice thing for investigation, but also here we have a difference between software and hardware. For instance, if you see this progress bar, you know, it's quite a simple thing. If you see a race or so, the runners are running from the start to the end and you see some progress, this is a simple process. There's no real invention in this thing if you use it in software, but perhaps I should have to pay a license fee for these slides, because I used the patent of the firma IBM, and so, well, I think they will not care about my slides, but you see, there is also a difference in patents if it is about hardware and about software. There are so stupid, simple things patented in software which simply makes no sense. Or, for instance, in Germany or in the complete EU is a patent if you store your files with file names that have a date inside. So if I store a file today with 2007 06 16 as the date of today, then and I make it available over network drive, I will break the, or I would have to pay license fee to this company who owns this patent. And so there are some very stupid things which are possible in software and patent issues. So this was about the commercial software. People, at least these people, I wanted to tell about free software tend to talk about freeware. They just say freeware. What do they mean with freeware? There are three different things about so-called freeware. This is, for most people, this is just one thing, but I think at a Debian conference we should differentiate between the download here software. You can download binary software and use it. This is kind of free beer. You can go to a pub, get drunk, and, well, this is really nice, but getting drunk is not the only thing we want. We want a little bit more. We want to know whether the beer we have drunken is, well, poisoned, whatever. We don't know. And so it is good if you have the code of the software and can look into the code and do what the code is doing on your machine. So there is a second type of freeware. You can look at the code. You can so hear everything what is said in this code, but you can't change it. You can't say anything about, which means making new code and make a better program. And now we come to free software. Free software is by definition something where you can have all rights to change the code and do whatever you want with the code. And this is the main point. It is not about the price of the software, it is about the right to change the software. So the free is more centered on the rights you have and not on the price. So where's the catch? Everybody asks where's the catch. If there is something what doesn't cost anything, it can't be worth something. So the catch is free, in our sense, does not mean free of charge. So, as I said, it is the main focus is on the right to use the software. And it is more in the sense of the free speech. And free speech is not always simple. If you are living in a country where the free speech is not so, well, not the government does not really like to have people free speech, then it needs some strengths to do some speeches, and you need some competence to do clever some speeches, and you need also some time to prepare the speech. And so in these three points, for example, are hidden some costs. The person who does a free speech has to be able to do the speech, and he needs some time, and he just have to do something for living. And so these costs are hidden in the free software. What exactly is free software is defined in the Debian Free Software Guidelines. This presentation is online, and there is a link, and I think everybody will find it. So what about free knowledge? Do we have alternatives to freedom also in the knowledge? Because software is also some kind of knowledge which is just turned into a functionality. Free knowledge, you might know Wikipedia. If not, just look at wikipedia.org and look up your special field, and you see, well, this is good, this is nice knowledge, or you see, this is not so good, and then you have the chance to make it better. Just try it. And the interesting thing is, well, this is some kind of spam mail. The interesting thing is that these people claim that their source was Wikipedia. And this is interesting because our enemy takes us honest. And this is interesting. We also have some free software to get it to the rubbish, but this is an interesting point that from some point in time, the enemy thinks, well, there is something we should not ignore anymore. So what is the user expecting from software in general? A user wants some long-term continuous functionality. This is important to do the day-to-day work. And most users, believe it or not, do not really care about the software is free or not free. They just want a program that works. And the users also have some expectations in the program and the service they get. If they have some trouble with the program, they want some service to get the program running. And well, the user has a budget, and this budget is split into program and service. If the program is for free, it's more money to get the service, and so he is probably happy with free software. So, open source is living from contributors, and so the idea is if I get more people using open source software, I get more contributors. So my customers as a free software provider are contributing back to me and are in this way contributors who can enhance my code. So in general, the quality increases with the number of users I have for my program. At least if they understand the principle that software is not something they have to accept, but they can change. If they send bug reports or whatever, then I can enhance my software and so they get a better product for their own work. This is, I have many colleagues who are not involved in the free software worlds and they really wonder if it has any sense to send a bug report to the producer of their software. So the producer of the, some software has once issued this nice advertising. I really like it. It was not only to promote Linux, more the other thing, but it's called Get the Facts. And what can we learn from it? Well, Gandhi said, first they ignored you, then they lauded you, then they fight you, and then you win. And it is nice to know that since 2002, the phase three where they fight at you. Very sorry, this is not working anymore. Since 2002, we are in phase three where they fight against us, and this is very optimistic in my opinion because phase four is approaching, I think. So what about the power of distribution? Well, imagine we have a user who has happily bought some hardware and thinks, I have heard there is some free software around and, I just want to try my luck and install an operating system. This is called Linux and I found for free in the internet. Now I need some graphical interface, and he had learned, Linux is not so nice, but there are some graphical interfaces, for instance, GNOME, of course there are others, but just for example. And the user needs a browser, and, finds a browser, and he always grabs the source from the net, compiles itself, and is a very brave user, and he also installed a mail client and, I don't know how long it takes if a user the source compiles this on his own machine, does this all from scratch, but I think even if it is a quite clever user, after this step he is not so happy as he was before because he spent at least one day of time if he is quite good. So if it comes to some Office suite or some typesetting system and nice drawing program, he is even less happy because it takes very long time. It would be much faster if he would crack some programs or so and use the installers which are only free of charge and so. It is not real fun until he is able to install free web servers and databases, and so this user is wondering, what is the sense of this free software? I spent, perhaps until he reached this stage 1 week to get a free system running, and perhaps he was able to earn money of £1,000 in this week, and so he was able to buy all this software on the commercial side. But, this is not really the sense of free software. The sense is you have the possibility to take the source and compile your programs yourself, but why not asking others to do it for you? And so others did it and built a distribution. This is a distribution the user can put on his computer, and the time he spent is worth some money. And this slide quite clearly explains why this box has to cost something. It is worth 1 week of work for the user. And so this is my answer if people ask me, well, Linux, well, I have seen a box, it costed £100 or so. Well, I thought it was free, right? It is not free, I have to pay money. Yes, you have to pay money for all this work which is done in this box. This is the most reasonable way to install free software instead of doing all the work. You have the right to do the work, but you don't need it. What is the difference to Debian? Well, Debian is also kind of a box. And the user can install it on the computer. But he has not really to pay money, because Debian is a free distribution. And the interesting thing about Debian is that all these people, the Debian developers, I'm one of these funny people, have some interest to, well, put these software into the Debian distribution for their own use. So they do it anyway. And if these people do this work to take the source, compile the code, and upload it to get it in the distribution, they think, well, if I do it for me, I can do it for somebody else, and somebody else will do some other program. And so this distribution is built on a community effort, which is an interesting alternative. But, well, for instance, here, I told you I'm one of them, and there's somebody else in the room who is also building some software. The alternative is we are not really people who have an interest to bring our software to the customer in the first place. We just want to build a very good operating system for our own. We have not the interest to make money with this. And this makes some interesting difference. A distributor, the commercial distributor, has interest to serve the mass market to make some money. This is fine. Some special software is missing in his boxes because, well, the mass market is kind of a general thing. And you cannot earn much money if you try to support, for instance, schools, or if you try to support small market niches, or try to support some special kind of sciences or so. Well, these people are, well, the distributor expects that these people take over the work I described before for their special software. And the solution in Debian is that many specialists, like these funny people, build the software they are interested in, they need, and where they are competent for, and put all this into the distribution. So Debian grows to quite large distribution. This, well, Debian is the largest distribution, but this doesn't matter. It is in this way interesting because things are included that are not in any other distribution. Well, nice image. What does it mean? Every red circle is a place where one of these specialists is sitting all over the world. This is quite an old map. We unfortunately have no current map, but you see the red circles are spread, well, all over the world. Is unfortunately not so, well, yeah, the empty places, yes, you see. It would be nice to have some sitting there. And all these people are connected by lines, and every line means one Debian developer who is sitting on one red circle has met another developer, and they exchange their keys, so they trust each other. It's a problem if you have a network of people who are working together. How can they trust each other? How can they know that somebody who claimed to have done something did really has really done it, or was it somebody else? And so we have to build this network of trust, and this is the form we try to build this, so to, well, to to show graphical how we are connected. So I've told special programs are interesting in Debian. The development of free software is kind of an evolutionary process, and it is very successful if you have many users for a program. So it is no problem at all to find many users and many developers for a web browser. So it is perfectly clear that Firefox has so many users that are amongst these users are very talented, if gifted, developers who develop this software. The special software has quite a small user base. So if you think of my hobby horse is the medicine, if you think of doctors running a practice, there are not so many gifted programmers and even less people who are clever software engineers who try to work on free software. So this is a problem to get very special software in a free software distribution. And we have a certain profile for these specialists. It is and normally not reasonable effort to install upstream programs. So if there is some free software which fits the needs of a specialist, he is, if you think of a doctor, is just busy to care for his patients and not for his software. So he needs somebody who does the work to install this program for him. They are also not interested in administration. These specialists want a computer who just works. They will not try to care about any configuration of Apache or whatever. And the interesting is they need only a quite defined subset of available free software, which is, as I mentioned before, not available in commercial distributions because this commercial distributor does not expect to get a good market share from this special software. The profile of the administrator for those specialists is, he has also a limited time frame because he has to care about many different things, and he has also a lack of specialist knowledge. So I know it from my field, or I know it from the Debian Edu people, there are teachers who are in this group who develops such a distribution for schools, but there are also programmers who have no idea how schools are working and who have even no idea who are schools working in different countries. And so the administrator, that is in principle, are we also administrators of the machines of the specialist, has not really always an idea what his user really wants. And this is kind of a problem I faced quite frequently. So, well, this is also a user who has installed Debian, who just managed it, and he is looking at the descriptions of the 18,000 packages. And, well, it is not really, it's just confusing because the 18,000 package descriptions are written in a language he doesn't really understand, and if he understands the language, he understands maximum 50% of the content. So, how to help these people? We can do the following. We can make some focus on this really huge software pool. And this focus is, for instance, if I'm a teacher, I think, well, I'm interested in the educational software. And I'm looking for only the piece of Debian that contains this software. And so some people sit down and say, well, we want to support those people and made a so-called custom distribution, which is Scala Linux or Debian Edu. And so everything around is not any more interesting for those people. They just focus on this software they really need. And well, I entered Debian in 1996. There was quite less software. I don't know how many packages. And even then, it was not possible for me to browse all the packages that are available. And I had to do the configuration I needed for my special purpose. And at the current stage, 10 years later, it is really impossible to find all the things and really notice which programs exist in Debian. I know many people who thought, well, I just got the source from this program and compiled it, and I asked him, why didn't you use the Debian package? Oh, there's a Debian package, that's nice. So we just take over this work, and there's another project, Debian Meet, which is my hobby horse a little bit, and I'm doing the same for medical persons who can be split up in medical practitioners, which are not really good supported because there is not so much free software for these people, but there is also some biological software, microbiological software that is, we have about 40 packages inside Debian, and the support for those people is just to make them aware of this software. I know many biologists who need certain software, but they have no idea which free software exists, and so we can give them some support. In this way, we say, just install this package, and this cares for the installation of all the stuff you are interested in, what we have in our distribution. So this is, in my opinion, this is the real power we have. We can prepare a ready-to-run system for all users, not only, here is Debian, the distribution, but we can also care for people who have very special interests, who are specialized to fields that are not mainstream and not just an office suite or whatever. If we learn that this is a real power we have in Debian, we can get even more users who are really happy with Debian, and let's see how it works. So, in general, about knowledge, power, and free beer, I think it is a little bit premature for euphoria, and we are on a nice level. As told you, somebody else is fighting against us. This is a very good sign. And, you know, some other examples, companies make some agreements about not issuing somebody else, and so it is an interesting time where we live in, and I hope that this interesting times end in a state where we are even more happy than we are now. Well, we as a developers really appreciate support from everybody, so if everybody learned something from this talk, which I would be happy about, just join us, tell us your problems. We really like to care about your problems because it's just fun to fix problems, and not only for the sake of it to fix problems, but it is nice to see people who are smiling if they are using our software. Yes, we had some first competitions with proprietary systems. So there are some rankings between famous web browsers, and I think the tendency is not bad. So there are some rankings between some famous databases, and we are not really bad. And if you think you learned something from this talk, you can ask your software producer also some questions. For instance, what is the sense of a dongle? I've working in an institute, there are many computers featuring a dongle in the back, and sometimes the USB ports are not enough, or there are some dongles stacked one over the other, and it's not really fun, but users don't ask. Well, it's a software and the dongle, put it in it, it should work, but they don't ask, what's the sense of this? How fast can a bug that was asked for fixing is really fixed. If you did you ever try to call a service hotline if they are able to fix a bug? Well, this is really interesting. I'm not saying that every bug in free software is fixed immediately, but for instance, in Debian, you have a certain person who is responsible, and you know who is this person. And this is one reason why bugs are normally fixed quite fast, not always. But this is you can issue, you can ask this person, what's wrong? Can I help you? Or is it possible that somebody else can fix this bug? And this is a quite a difference of calling a hotline. Well, waiting some loops of nice music until you reach somebody, or sending a bug report and getting some email can you give some more information, or just as easy, I fix this. This is some difference. Then you can ask companies, what will you really lose if you release your code? For instance, if you remember the story of Firefox, it was formerly Netscape, Mozilla, and the company Netscape had some trouble. They had the most famous web browser one time, and then they lost some market share. They lost more and more, and finally they thought, well, we have no real chance, we just release our code. Or you have seen it in OpenOffice. This is an interesting effect that people or that companies who are providing a commercial software or a proprietary software and see, well, we cannot compete with the market, just release their code, because this is the only chance to survive. And finally, if you look at those projects like Firefox and OpenOffice, they were the winner in this process to survive, because they really survived and they do a really good job. So the question is, what will a company lose if the code is released? And perhaps some other questions you might have for companies. So, I do not want to talk anymore in this place. You can find these slides on this webpage, and there's also a written version of this, what I told you, perhaps a little bit more, perhaps a little bit, well, not so bad pronounced English, it's just written. I'm sorry for that. And if you have some questions, it's your turn now. I can give you the mic. I come down. Give you the mic.
What is your opinion of the dual licensing? I have friends who have two licenses on the same program.
Yeah, yes, well, if at least one license is free, I have no problem with it.
Okay, is this on? Yeah.
Okay, his concept was one license for contributors.
Excuse me, one more?
One license in order for contributors to help.
Yeah.
A second license for him to make a profit from service.
Yes.
Okay, if someone wants to use that business model, what would you advise as the contributor license, and what would you advise as the service model license?
Well, this is a little bit hard to give advice, because, as I said, if one license is free for contribution or whatever, and you can also people can use it for commercial reasons. For instance, if you have the BSD license, who allows to make some other profit from it. It is hard to decide or you wait this business models. I think it is nice if people have a free license and a difference license to make some money, because these people have to live. And if these people are not able to run their company, this software would be orphaned, and this would be bad. So it is a little bit hard to give advice which is the right license. You have to ask a lawyer to give a competent answer for this. I'm really no lawyer.
The problem I had, I would like for the license to say that as long as you are giving the source to somebody else,
yes,
and it is free, that is okay. But if you are a proprietary system and you grab this for a proprietary system, that is not allowed in the license. Well, that's a very tricky legal question as to how you can do that.
It depends from the GPL wouldn't allow this, what you say, but if you use a BSD license, which is also free, it allows. And it was interesting for me because I didn't understand the sense of this BSD license, which allows to base closed software on this. This is allowed, but the sense was explained to me in private, because the United States want to spread knowledge between the people and also the companies. And the companies are also part of the United States, and so these should also profit from this software or this knowledge, and so it's quite okay for them to base also closed software on the this works.
Yeah, some of the licenses are very good for the big proprietary company who steals the open software, redoes it a little bit, and
I don't think that it is stealing. If I'm the author and I think it is okay for me if people use the software and close software, then it's a decision of the author. It's not stolen. If the author is not aware of the differences of the license, you should explain him. But I think it's not really stealing. Okay, somebody else?
I have a question, but just don't.
The mic is there.
Okay. Would it be fair to describe your sort of company more as a charity-based company?
Can you repeat the question?
Would you describe your company as, I'm not very technical, I'm not a technical person, but if I'm looking at the presentation, would you describe yourself as a charity-based company? Because surely you're not competing well in Europe. Would that be fair to say? I mean, on your map, when you looked at Africa, for example, you don't have many systems there. Are you trying to target Africa, or do you compete mostly in Europe?
Well, we are just an organization who everybody is free to join. We are not advertising people, ask people to join us. They just can join. And if we would be happy if people from the white spots would join us. And as I said, the map is not really up to date. It is not the white spots are not so white anymore, but there are large white spots. It is just the problem that if there are areas which have a not so good infrastructure, they have not so many computers, and the knowledge that there is free software is not so widespread as it is in other countries. So if these people grow up with computers, they will get the sense of free software. And I'm really sure that especially in these countries will join much more people than from anywhere else. But we have not the power to ask those people, well, come to us. That's not our point.
Okay, thank you very much.
Anybody else? If not, we'll make a 5 minutes break until the next talk. See? Yeah, 5 minutes? Okay. Thank you very much.